Hope you all find the presentation interesting and will join us for follow-up presentations as well. Now on to the agenda. Our discussion begins with some basic principles of aggregation and how to do it right, some key elements for success. We then move on to the key differentiators of the Tradable aggregation solution. And finally, we'll open the floor up for questions. In order to ask the questions, please use the chat window that's on the right of the presentation. Hopefully, you'll be able to see it. You'll be able to send or post those chats to me, and then I'll look through those questions, and hopefully we'll be able to get to most of the questions for this presentation. We only plan on spending about a half an hour in this webinar just to keep it light and easily digestible. Let's begin. In order to start, I just want to give a brief introduction to who I am and who Tradables is. My name is Aaron Haver. I'm the Vice President of Strategic Services at Tradables. I've been with the company since 2003, and now I'm responsible for product direction here at Tradables. Tradables was incorporated in 1997. It has its headquarters in New York, sales office in London, and our R&D is mostly done out of Israel. Our customers are typically FX desks of banks and brokers. And we offer two kinds of suites. One is our liquidity management platform, LMP, which is a full suite of FX trading software, including the typical module that you find in the sell-side suite of FX trading software, as well as LightFX, which is our on-demand, cloud-based aggregation service. LightFX is what we introduced this year and has really met tremendous success and take up from the marketplace. We're very excited about that. This webinar is not specifically going to address LightFX, although LightFX is obviously about aggregation, so a lot of what we're saying here will apply to any potential or current customers of LightFX as well. With that, I'm going to move on to our guest speaker, Mark Bertheim from Bayern, and I'll pass the microphone over to him to just give an introduction for himself and of the bank. So, Mark?
Aaron, thank you very much. Yeah, just a brief introduction of myself. I'm running the foreign exchange trading desk here in Munich at the Bayern LB for about 4 to 5 years now. And been involved in the e-business development since that. Before that, I used to work at Westerby as a foreign exchange trader, used to be an asset liability portfolio manager and head of the portfolio risk management. Just a brief description about the Bayern LB itself. We are a regional-focused bank which covers wholesale business, but also some part of the retail via our savings banks. And we are in the foreign exchange business quite successfully at the moment and for the past few years.
Okay, thank you, Mark. And just one more additional thing. We, I'd say Bayern has been a customer trader tool since before February 2010. We went live with our aggregation solution at Bayern in February 2010 and is obviously being used right now on the trading floor. So thanks again, Mark.
Yeah.
I think to get into the discussion about aggregation, before we move too much further, I think we just want to give a brief description of what we're referring to, because I think liquidity aggregation has gotten a lot of press. It's a term that's used in other marketplaces, including equities. Specifically for FX, just to use a definition that we can use when moving forward, liquidity aggregation is really the collection or collecting of incoming streams of liquidity into a single pool. So that is what you're doing when you're aggregating liquidity. You're taking different sources of liquidity and you're putting them together into one pool. That description doesn't really say very much. It doesn't speak too much to the applications of that pool of liquidity, of the aggregation. And so there are many applications for liquidity aggregation, both on the pre-trade, on the pricing side of things. So obviously, if you're going to be either distributing prices internally in your own institution or
sending them or presenting them to your customer either over the phone or electronically, what you would want to do is have the prices that you are making available to be based on the actual liquidity that is available to you. And the reasons are obvious. You want to be able to make sure that when those prices are being dealt upon, that that you'd be able to manage that risk that's coming back into your institution. And the best way to manage that risk is to know that those prices were based on what's actually available to you. It's actually, you know, similar to any wholesale retail type of business, although I don't want to use those terms specifically in the FX world, but when a retail institution is giving prices, even if it's a store and is giving prices to its customers, obviously what it wants to do is take whatever the cost of itself bringing in the inventory into its own institution, take that cost and then spread it further on to its customers. And that's the way it works in general in the marketplace, and that's clearly the way it works in FX or really any asset class. That's on the pre-trade side of things, and on the trading side of things, of course, there are other applications. A typical application might be for algo trading, so you want to be able to set up an engine that is looking at a pool of liquidity and is based on certain opportunities that are in the marketplace or based on certain positions in the bank, wants to be able to trade into that marketplace. So you want to aggregate that liquidity for use of that engine. There's position management. So if you're an institution that has customers and you're distributing prices to those customers, you want to be able to manage the risk that's coming back into your institution. And the best way to manage that risk is to look at the current positions that you have and then to reduce your risk by going into the market. The best way to go into that market is to look at the total view of liquidity that's available to you. Operationally, it also has benefits because if you are aggregating all of your pools into one place, you'd be able to, first of all, provision your hardware and software better and also be able to address your straight-through processing needs potentially from one specific place instead of from multiple places. So there are a lot of applications and benefits to aggregating liquidity. Today's focus will be on specifically human trading in the dealing room, so the benefits to traders in the dealing room. And that's what we want to focus on specifically for today's discussion. And maybe in future discussions on this series of webinars, we'll address some of the other applications as well. So maybe now is a good time for me to just turn over to Mark again and to ask to Mark how important he thinks it is to maintain a single view of all the liquidity that's available to an FX business.
Well, I think that's one of the reasons why I was looking for aggregation is the fact that I can't, or the trader can't, look at, let's say, five single dealer platforms for, let's say, Eurodollar for 10, 20, or 50 million euros and find the best price in the fastest way. So this is impossible.
Right.
And that's I think, one of the main reasons. I said, okay, he needs to have a look at one place and find the market with the best liquidity and the best pricing. That was the first goal.
Are you looking at some of the other applications for aggregation as well on the pricing side or on the, on the position management side?
Yeah, I used to. I mean, you mentioned it before. We are live with Trader Tools since more than 2 years. So before that, I definitely had a look around in the market about other vendors as well, what they offered that time. But there were several reasons why I took Trader Tools. So I didn't only look at the Trader Tools back then,
sure,
but decided after a process of reviewing all the pros and cons.
Okay, so I think if we're just to summarize it, I think the most important thing that aggregation offers is really a single view of liquidity, which helps your business achieve optimal pricing and trading results as well as optimal operational efficiency. Now, to speak specifically about what aggregation means for traders, these are some of the things that Mark mentioned himself. What does aggregation add for a human who's sitting in front of an aggregation trading screen? Number one, a single view of the market for optimum decision making. Number two, uses less real estate on your desktop if you have one place to look at all the liquidity that's available to you instead of looking at multiple, either single bank platforms or ECNs at the same time. A deeper pool of liquidity for larger trades, so instead of having to split a large trade up across multiple venues, here you have one place to be able to put in your larger trades, and better executions due to the larger pool of prices competing for the order flow. So those two last benefits are something, is a theme that we're going to get to again further in the presentation. What does aggregation provide? It provides a deeper pool and provides better execution. So those are two business needs, both to be able to address the inventory needs of, how much liquidity you have to have available to you in order to be able to do your business, as well as getting the best prices you can out of that liquidity. I thought, Mark, maybe it would be useful if you could just give a brief description of how your business changed since before you had aggregation and after you added aggregation to your traders' desktop.
Sure. Well, you mentioned one of it. It's definitely about a deeper liquidity for the single trader. I mean, I have about 10 traders on the desk, so if I collect them all together, then I have the same liquidity, but now every single dealer has the liquidity of, let's say, 10. And with definitely better spread on one single screen. And I want to mention one thing which is quite important and why the trader uses trader tools more active than let's say the other tools still around is imagine you have a stop loss order. A human trader can't definitely react as fast as a machine can. So you can input the stop loss order for the trader's position, and most of the time I would say he's very happy with the filling of the stop. Even a stop is not a happy thing, but the price is.
Sure. Okay. So if we're addressing what when you're talking about an aggregation platform for a trading desk, one of the first questions that comes up is what type of liquidity should you be looking at in order to put into your aggregation platform? And really, there are two main types of liquidity, ECN liquidity and single bank-based liquidity. It's our experience that ECN-based liquidity may be suitable for some applications where the buy side wants to maintain anonymity, maybe an algo engine for trading, may be good and useful for certain other applications. But for trader-based trading, where the trader has nothing to hide and maintains good relationships with market makers and is not doing anything untoward to those market makers, in our experience, single bank liquidity is ideal. And the reason it's ideal is that only single bank feeds can give a trader an optimal performance on a price stream. And the reason is that if you're getting a stream directly for your needs, it's tailored for you, and it's based on the relationship that you have with that bank, that stream should be the best possible prices available to you from that taker, from that provider. If they weren't, then obviously you wouldn't be dealing against that that provider's prices. So from our perspective, aggregators, certainly for traders on the desktop, should be all about relationship pricing. Better relationships means better prices for you. And really what we think is that if you want to determine, if you want to know whether an aggregator is something that you should be looking at for your own business, it's a very simple, straightforward question. And that is, do you have more than one single bank platform on your desktop? If you have more than one single bank platform, that implies that you're interested in the relationships that you have with those providers of that platform. And if you're interested in those relationships, it must mean because they're giving you superior service. If you then take those relationships and instead of having them distributed across multiple platforms, but put them into one aggregator, that has to be really the optimal service that you can get from your liquidity provider. So for us, aggregation is all about relationship pricing. And for that reason, I think, when we are speaking to our customers, we really are trying to make sure to optimize those relationships that they have with those liquidity providers that they have. So, Mark, how important are relationships for you in receiving best price? How important do you think the relationship is that you have with any liquidity provider to receiving the best price available for you?
Well, from my point of view, it's very important. It's one of the key components of the business. It has been before aggregation, and it's still. That's why I decided, together with my liquidity providers, not to use an ECN. There might be several reasons for that. Doing that, it's not good for me or for my business which I'm running, and I'm still happy without the ECNs, aggregated intra-trader tools. So it's all about relationship from my point of view, and not only for the FX spot business, but the overall business I'm doing with the relationship.
Sure. Okay, so once you've decided what kind of liquidity that you want to bring into your aggregator, the next common question is, well, how many liquidity providers should you be looking at to aggregate? As we said before, there are really two business reasons for adding liquidity providers. Number one, to get access to deeper liquidity. And number two, to be able to get better prices so those liquidity providers will be competing for your business. So really, what we try to instill on with our customers is that the optimal number of liquidity providers is the smallest number that provide the required depth at the tightest prices. I think there's a prevalent notion in the marketplace that, well, more liquidity providers must be better, so let's try to get as many liquidity providers as possible. That's usually the way some of our customers start out with us, but really relationship pricing that we discussed in the previous slide means you're giving providers the flow for better prices. It's a two-way relationship. You're giving them flow and they're giving you better prices. And if you increase the number of liquidity providers beyond the amount of liquidity that you need to have access to, what will end up happening is that you're going to spread that liquidity across those providers, and each one is going to have less of an incentive to give you a better price. So really what you want to do is you want to look at those two business needs. You want to look at the need of getting deeper liquidity. In other words, how much volume do you expect to do in your business? And number two, okay, well, this is how much I expect to do. How many liquidity providers do I need to be able to, in my pool, to be able to get the best prices for me? But anything beyond the what I need for my liquidity requirements really is beyond the optimal amount for your aggregator. From our experience, the optimal number of liquidity providers for achieving best prices is roughly 6 to 8. That's really just 6 to 8 liquidity providers. That's just a rule of thumb. Some customers want more, some customers want less. That's for getting best prices. Of course, if you have a requirement for deeper liquidity, then you should be, and you're planning on doing sizable liquidity across all your liquidity providers, then obviously, then you should be looking at more liquidity providers. But typically, we're looking at somewhere between 6 to 8. The important thing is really to realize that quality is important, not just quantity. You want your relationships with your liquidity providers that are in your aggregator. You want to get the most out of those relationships and not just include many liquidity providers just to have additional providers to compete for your business. Once you've done that, once you've decided on your initial set of liquidity providers, the next step might be to optimize those liquidity providers per currency pair. So we have to realize, and what we see from our own experience with our customers, certain liquidity providers might be better for certain currency pairs for you, and so you might want to have additional liquidity providers for specific currency pairs as well. So that might be another step of optimization on top of the initial set. So I guess, Mark, how many providers do you have configured in the aggregator? One.
Currently, I have exactly seven. However, I'll work on an onboarding for one more. But I fully agree on 6 to 8 looks to be the optimal number. It changes over time the development with the liquidity provider. So one could be number one 1 month and going down to number three, and so it's an ongoing process. And from my experience, five of them, if you talk about seven, five of them provides really steady service, and there's always one who can't compete to the others, but you still should have one, maybe to replace with another one and try them out and get them business. That's what our customer does with the banks, and so I think that might be a good idea also to change from time to time. But yeah, I'm very happy with the seven at the moment.
It might be useful, Mark, for some of our listeners to hear what kind of a process you would go through to add a liquidity provider. So let's say you decided that you were increasing your volume and your business was growing and you wanted to add a liquidity provider. What would be the process in picking, choosing a liquidity provider?
Well, first of all, this liquidity provider should have a strong foreign exchange business and a strong technology to really stream those prices an aggregator would need. I think that's very important. You can't give somebody who just started with doing foreign exchange business in this area a chance. I can't, because I need the good prices, high prices right away. That it makes sense for both of us. You mentioned it before. It's relationship, and it's a two-way business. That's very important. And so that's why it's important for me. It should be one of the top 10 or top 20 FX banks, I would say. And then it depends on how much business I do with them on the other areas, let's say on the option side, on the money market side, or even loan business. So it's the overall relationship with that bank what brings me to the decision to say, okay, I want to take LP number 1, 2, and 3.
Right. Okay. Thanks for that, Mark. I think the next step is once you've decided what your base of your liquidity providers are going to use for your aggregator, the next question is how do you get the most out of your aggregator and the service that's being provided by your liquidity providers? And in our experience, the best way to optimize an aggregator is to monitor constantly its performance. It's, you know, if you just think that you deploy an aggregator and then you step back and let things happen the way they are, that's fine, but you're not going to really get optimal performance. What you really want to be able to do is go through a cyclical process. If you look at the slide, it really starts with configuring your base set of liquidity providers, executing against that base set of liquidity providers, analyzing statistics that come out of the executions that you did with those liquidity providers. When you're looking at it, you're looking at what was your fill percentage against a liquidity provider, or which currency pairs is one doing better at or another. And then you go back to the liquidity providers who you have the relationships with, and you negotiate to see if you can get better prices. You're basically saying, you know, if you want to increase flow to me, this is what you have to do. If you give me those tighter prices, I will increase my flow with you. You go back to configure your aggregator to meet those new rules that you've negotiated with a liquidity provider, and then again you go through that cycle of executing and analyzing it. This is something that we do with our customers on an ongoing basis. We provide statistics to our customers to make sure that they're constantly getting the feedback of how is the aggregator performing and how each liquidity provider is performing. I know, Mark, you make use of the statistics that we share with you. Can you think of an instance, maybe without names, where you use the statistics to change configuration with a liquidity provider or to negotiate with a liquidity provider?
Well, I did this twice during the past 2 years with regards to specify the volumes, the average notional trade on specific currency pairs with specific liquidity providers, and share these information anonymously to the liquidity providers, and make sure that I have a setup with regards to the perfect volume, and then the spread, and the maximum volume, and so on. So I did this twice because it's quite sophisticated, and you have to go into detail. That's the one side. And now I feel quite comfortable to have a good setup. This doesn't mean I won't do this in the future, but not on a monthly basis. What I do on a monthly basis is just to share the information, what liquidity provider who has which market share in which currency pair, and whether the liquidity provider itself is satisfied with his, let's say, position, with the volume he's trading with me, and so on. So this is an ongoing, a regular share of information with those liquidity providers, I have to be honest, who wants this. Not everybody wants this discussion. Most of my liquidity providers want, and they I think they benefit also from this information.
Sure. Okay. Thanks, Mark. Just one last slide, I think, just to kind of pull it all together. And maybe to give you an idea of why we think that the Trader Tools solution is the best in the marketplace. I think there's a misconception in the market that aggregation is really a commodity. You just, it seems very simple. You just, electronically connect to a liquidity provider, you put all the information together, you present it to a trader, you take back the order requests and you send them to those liquidity providers. It sounds like a very straightforward thing. What we've found and what we've found talking to our customers and speaking to our liquidity providers is that all aggregators are not equal. And I think what separates Trader Tools from maybe the other providers of aggregation solutions is that we are committed to relationship pricing, and that really flows through in everything that we do. We make sure that liquidity is configured according to the specific needs of each individual customer and each individual customer's relationship to each individual liquidity provider. We maintain active three-way relationships between us, the liquidity providers, and our customers. We have people that are responsible for constantly being in contact with liquidity providers, whether it's for a customer or even just between us and liquidity providers, to make sure that we have an understanding, a good understanding between each other. And also, we facilitate relationships between liquidity providers and our customers to make sure that there's good information flowing between them. We are committed to a cost-free model for liquidity providers. We do not charge liquidity providers for their liquidity. Basically, the way we see ourselves is a facilitator, a technology facilitator between the customers and the liquidity providers, the banks and the brokers and whatever, with the liquidity providers. We're there just to provide the technology to facilitate that relationship. We believe that our smart order routing functionality is unique to us because it looks both at the relationships with the liquidity providers as well as trying to get the best prices for our customers. That is not something that should be taken for granted. I think it's something that we've gone through many iterations on to make sure that we are tailored both to make the liquidity providers as well as our customers happy. Again, it feeds back to relationship pricing. If the liquidity providers are not happy or the customers are not happy, then the relationships are not working. And so it's something that we invest a lot of time in. Detailed statistics is something we provide both to our customers as well as to liquidity providers. These are anonymously. In other words, we will not say the names of our customers if they don't want us to, but we want to make sure the liquidity providers understand why they are or are not getting volume for each specific customer or across the board with our aggregator. And then finally, an easy-to-use, rich user interface to our customers, traders that are sitting on the desktop, so that they're able to get the best access they can to the liquidity that's being made available to them from those liquidity providers. some of the things that I've covered here in bullets, I mean, we don't have much time to go into it. Maybe these will be topics for further discussion. But I think you know, all of these bullets together really makes up what our solution is, and how, again, we are committed to the relationship pricing. I don't know, Mark, this was a little while back, but I don't know if you can remember what were the factors that were important to you when you chose Trigger Tools?
Different kind of issues. First of all, definitely the suite of options that Trader Tools offers for the future, not only aggregation. You mentioned smart order routing, maybe in-house white labeling solutions, something like that. So ongoing development on Trader Tools, not only the aggregation side of it. And a very important point, especially for me, was the STP to my front office system. Because that worked. Sorry?
Yeah, no, that was actually something that I did not mention. That's something that shouldn't be taken for granted. But if I remember correctly, in Byron's case, it was done really within a day, I believe. The whole thing was in place, and we'll be able to flow to the front office system.
Exactly, and I have to admit, I don't have a simple front office tool, unfortunately, and so I was surprised, very much surprised on that side. So Trader Tools showed that time at a proof of concept that they can deliver what they really offer, and that was one of the main criteria. Looking back now, for the last two years, I would say the most important things are two. First of all, I make money out of it for the business. And second is the trader uses Trader Tools. They don't need to, but they still have single dealer and ECNs, but they use Trader Tools. So, they decide on that.
Okay, thanks, Mark. I think we're kind of nearing the end of the time here. So I'm just going to open it up for the questions that we've received. Just a question for Mark, although I think that's something that I should answer, is why didn't you use the hosted solution? So when we went live with Byron, we didn't offer a hosted solution. I don't know if that was the reason why you didn't go with a hosted solution, but I guess the question might be, would you be interested in a hosted solution now, or are you happy with it being hosted at Byron itself?
Well, it's a technical issue, isn't it? I should discuss this with my IT department. But honestly, I thought about it. I thought about it now that I knew about. But 2 years back, you didn't offer it, and so I invested in my hardware here, and so I have it, and I use it.
Sure. Okay, this may be something, this is a question I guess for me more, but how long does a typical implementation take? And so that's a good question. I think, again, we have now two kinds of offerings that we provide, both hosted and non-hosted. So obviously the length of a typical implementation depends on whether we're providing the hardware and software or whether the bank is providing the hardware and software. What are the key elements for how long an implementation takes? Well, there are three real factors. One is setting up the liquidity providers, I think, the straight-through processing. So in the case of, in Mark's case, it's actually really quick. But really the issue is, for straight-through processing, what kind of a front office system we're integrating with and whether the IT staff has got an API setup so they're able to implement very quickly. And, of course, the third is hardware provisioning, which, again, in a hosted solution is not really much of an issue, but when you're hosting at a bank, obviously that's something that that takes its time to be put into place. So those are really the factors for an implementation. I've actually thought that maybe one of the webinars that we might do in the future might go through a typical implementation with one of our customers so people get a better idea of what it takes. I don't know, Mark, I don't know if you can remember back to our implementation. I think with Byron, we started with, I believe, a proof of concept, I think. where you were able to see the prices for a short period of time. Is that right?
Yeah, exactly. Proof of concept, which included actually the STP issue. Honestly, I would say the implementation split between in-house doing and what trader tools needed to do was 90 to 10%, 10% on the trader tools side and 90% internally. And that took most of the time, but that was a specific situation within the bank. And you mentioned hardware. If you need to 6 months to buy a hardware, then it's an internal problem, isn't it? I could go to the next computer shop and buy it myself, but that's internal rules, and that was what cost me most of the time and negotiation and discussions. So I would say a good estimate from my side would be 2 to 3 months, something like that.
Right. Yeah, I think that was certainly typical of implementations that we do at a bank, where it includes getting liquidity providers provisioned and UAT set up and STP and so on. So that's I think that's fairly typical for banks. Okay, I mean, I think we're a little bit over time, so for now I think we're going to hold the questions, and I think maybe some of the questions that came in we'll answer through separate emails directly to the people that asked them, or maybe they'll be topics for upcoming webinars. I want to thank Mark and the attendees for the for joining us for this webinar, so thanks again, Mark. Upcoming topics that we might end up looking at for webinars would be similar discussions with other people from our customer base, which I think could be interesting for some of our customers and our potential customers, and as well as liquidity providers that might be on the line now. We want to look at light effects and more focused light to, no pun intended, to discuss the benefits of an implementation, and also to discuss aggregation for the enterprise, and maybe, as I said, we would look at a typical implementation project plan for an enterprise customer. Maybe we'll talk to some of our professional services staff and our customer-facing group staff. So, again, I appreciate everybody's time, and this concludes the webinar. So thanks again. Take care.
Thank you very much, Aaron. Just on my side, I'm really looking forward to the 3-0 against Italy this evening. So hope everybody
enjoys that. Good luck with that.
As well, yeah? Okay, thank you very much.
Good luck,
sir. Goodbye. Goodbye.